All right, we're good. Well, good evening, and welcome to New Testament Survey 2. And as many of you know, we're engaging in this study with others in advance. There'll be others that this lecture is being taped to share with, and so whether you're here tonight or whether you're in some other setting later on looking at footage, welcome to our class. And I want to begin this semester, so to speak, by looking at the Bible. Of course, that's what we're studying. But I'd like to look at the part of the Bible that this class is not about directly, and that's the Old Testament, and it's in particular Psalm 119, the book of Psalms. And I want to read a few verses that will remind us of the proper approach to the Word of God. It's a great privilege to have the Word of God. I just read, maybe you read yourself, but you know, I've got friends in Egypt, and I just read a news report, another Coptic, he was a school teacher, was shot in the head today. He was just walking home from school, and you know, a couple guys on a motorbike drove up and shot him. And this happens all the time. In Egypt, Christians are shot by non-Christians, by the majority population there. And it's a privilege to be able to live as a Christian. And one of the things that marks Christians is that they have a word from God that they recognize as God's word, and they hide it in their heart. And that word, as it comes to us, it saves us. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So I'm in Psalm 119, verse 97. And the psalmist here says, of course, at this point, the only scriptures that were complete were the books of Moses. And that was called the Torah, which means guidance or teaching. We translate it law, but it wasn't so much some bunch of legal prescriptions as it was guidance for Israel's life. And so the psalmist says, oh, how I love your Torah. And for us, that would be your scriptures. It is my meditation all the day. Your commandment makes me wiser than my enemies, for it is ever with me. I have more understanding than all my teachers, for your testimonies are my meditation. I understand more than the aged, for I keep your precepts. I hold back my feet from every evil way in order to keep your word. I do not turn aside from your rules, for you have taught me. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. You could be doing a lot of things in this hour, but here you are studying the word of God. And it's because there's something in it that's sweet to you. Through your precepts, I get understanding. Therefore, I hate every false way. There are things you could be doing on a Friday night that might not be the best for your moral health. And you've learned from the Word of God the benefit of devoting yourself to God through the study of His Word. So let us give Him thanks. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your Word, for your precepts, for your teachings, for your commands, for your guidance, for your instruction. We thank you that it is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. And we thank you that it points us to your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and that through him there is salvation, and there is hope, and there is meaning in this life and in the next. And we ask that you would guide us this evening and guide us throughout this course and strengthen us in your word and heighten our sense of joy in our study of it and knowledge of it and response to you through it. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we get to what in your handout material says Friday, 6:30, I just wanted to mention some books. I just have a box of them here. But these are all books that have come out, most of them in 2016. Now, this one was 2013. But they're all books on the truth and the authority of the Bible. And I'm not sure exactly, I'm kind of looking into it, why there is this flood of books. And in some cases, I know some of the authors here, and I mean, these are men and in some cases women at the top of their game, and they devoted their lives to the study of Scripture, and they're making, you know, sort of summary statements on their assessment of the truth of the Bible. Like Walt Kaiser, who's a well-known Old Testament scholar, he writes in this particular book, which is called In Defense of the Bible, A Comprehensive Apologetic for the Authority of Scripture. And then D.A. Carson at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School has this book, The Enduring Authority of the Christian Scriptures, about 40 essays from scholars on all kinds of subjects, scriptures in Islam, scriptures in Hinduism, scientific challenges to the Scripture, historical challenges to the Scriptures. If any of you know the work of John Piper, he's published a book on the truth and authority of the Bible called A Peculiar Glory. It's all about the truth of what we're studying. If you know the church historian Mark Knoll, here's a book called In the Beginning Was the Word, The Bible in American Public Life, 1492, familiar date, to 1783. So how was the Bible, what role did it play in colonial times leading up to the founding of our country? Nobody had ever really, you know, parsed that out and examined the sources for that particular question. Here's a book called God's Word Alone, The Authority of Scripture, What the Reformers Taught and Why It Still Matters by Matthew Barrett, a young scholar who's American, but he's teaching in England right now. And then I'll mention one more. This is really by a journalist, more than a biblical scholar, but his name is Kenneth Briggs, and it's called The Invisible Bestseller, Searching for the Bible in America. You know, brand new book, and he spent 2 or 3 years just going around the United States, talking to scholars, talking to common people, talking to health and wealth people, talking to Calvinists, talking to Arminians, you know, talking to everybody, studying the polls, and then writes this book, just sort of examining us. And if you read this book, you'll get a better sense for some of the polarities in America, some of the religious views and irreligious views, and how the Bible relates to them all. I just say this to encourage you. You're not concerning yourself tonight and tomorrow, and if you're here, you know, in the other two times we meet this spring, you're not concerning yourself with something that's a backwater that nobody much cares about except for some people in the church. But there's a vibrant study of Scripture in academia. And I'll say more as we go through this semester because it's an ongoing research interest of mine. But the Bible is an even bigger thing on other continents than it is in North America. I'll just throw out one statistic that just came to my attention. By the year 2050, 53% of all the Protestants in the world will be in Africa. 8% will be in North America. And at this moment, it's something like 12% in North America and 40% in Africa. I mean, we live in America, so naturally we're the center of the world, right? And in many ways, the United States is a central point. But when it comes to numbers of Christians, the United States compared to Africa is not a place where that many people are interested in the Bible and the church. But in other parts of the world, for various reasons, people are very interested in the Bible. So you're joining Africans, Asians, South Americans, and others who have much more interest in the Word of God than a lot of your country persons do, that is, countrymen or fellow Americans. All right, first of all, on page one of your handout, there's a review of New Testament Survey 1. It's a very, very quick review, and all of you who know the answers to these blanks that were here last semester, then you know, you get a gold star, and if you don't know the answers, then you're getting thrown out of the class. But this is a joint, it's a joint exercise, so if anybody knows the answer, then everybody gets credit for it. So, the whole Bible in summary, and over on the right, it just says the blank, period. What should go in that blank? What's the whole Bible about? The gospel. The gospel. See, somebody saved everybody else. They call that substitution. One for the many. The Old Testament is the... We just read from the Old Testament. The Old Testament is the... I'll give you a hint. Preparation. The preparation for the gospel. The Old Testament is the preparation for the gospel. The Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are the manifestation of the gospel. Now, of course, gospel means good news. And it's that word from God about who we are and what he has done for us that enables us to have communion with God. It enables us to have our sins forgiven and to come into the fellowship of God's people. That's why it's such good news, because otherwise we'd be in darkness and we'd be lost. So the Old Testament is the preparation for the gospel or the good news. The Gospels are the manifestation of the gospel. Acts is the expansion of the gospel. How did things go forth from Jesus who died on the cross? How did it go from that to churches at Corinth and Rome? Well, that's what Acts describes, the expansion of the gospel. The epistles, which is where we are tonight, are the explanation of the gospel. Or, you know, if you want a fancier word, especially if you were an English major, explication. You know, when I was an English major, we didn't just have an explanation of poems. You gave an explication of a poem. You gave it, an account of its meaning. And so the epistles explicate the gospel. They apply the gospel in various cities and situations. And then Revelation is the consummation. It's a consummation of the gospel. It all comes together in the end, and Revelation is a vision of that climax of God's redemptive work in the world and the entree into the age to come. So that's the whole Bible in summary. And it's very important when we read any part of the Bible that we keep the big picture in mind, because it's very easy to get lost in the forest and to be consumed with trying to figure out what a tree is that we're looking at and to despair. Well, I don't know what kind of tree that is. When actually, if we kind of back off and remember what the bigger forest is, we have a better view of the individual things we're looking at. And we're about to look at individual trees in the forest. Tonight it'll be Galatians, 1 Thessalonians, and 2 Thessalonians. But remember, we're not forgetting about what we studied earlier. We're not forgetting about the Old Testament background or the Second Temple period, the intertestamental period. We're not forgetting about Jesus coming and the Gospels and the book of Acts, all of which we've looked at earlier. We're just moving on now to an explication of what Jesus did and taught. And we read from Acts. We've seen in Acts how churches were planted. Now, what went on in those churches? And what's the meaning of that for our churches today and our lives today? That's what we're beginning tonight. I begin with a preview of the study of Paul's letters, because one of the chapters you read for tonight, well, chapter 17 of this book, if you got to it, if you didn't, you will. It's on the Apostle Paul. And so we recall Paul's statement that all Scripture is inspired by God. And it's profitable. That's an understatement. It's profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man or woman of God may be fully equipped for every good work. But the point I'm making there on your handout is that Paul's letters are co-authored. And I know sometimes he says Paul and Timothy or Paul and Timothy and Silas, but I'm not talking about Paul and Timothy. I'm talking about Paul and the Holy Spirit. We have Bibles, not only because we had holy people whom God called and gifted, but we have Bibles because there is a Spirit of God who spoke. And 1 Peter talks about that, that people were carried along by God and they wrote the scriptures. So remember that as we always remember that as we study Paul's letters, is that they're co-authored. And it's why we have traditionally in Bibles, I don't know about yours, or this one still has it, the Holy Bible. And the root meaning of holy in this sense, although a lot of people think it means sanctimonious or pious or something like that, the basic meaning of the word is different, singular, unique, set apart, unlike anything else of its kind. So when Scripture says about God, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. He's other, other, other. He's beyond our ken. He's not just a cosmic human. He's unique. There's no one like God. And there's no book like God's book. This is the Holy Bible. So we learn in that Holy Bible about someone named Paul. And on page 237 of your textbook, I've got a timeline here. And I won't go through it all, but if you look on the right side, it says Roman history. Remember, there's a historical setting for especially what we're studying in these sessions. Now, some of the Bible historical setting is not so critical. The book of Proverbs. You know, the book of Proverbs don't talk about, there's not a narrative there. There's not a lot of cities there. Nobody's going someplace and there's not a king reigning and then he does this and he says this and a prophet says something else. You know, there are historical books in the Old Testament. Some books are not historical. But all of the epistles that we're going to be studying tonight and tomorrow and the next few weeks, they all have a historical setting. They all took place under a certain Roman emperor. And when you get down about halfway down that timeline, you'll see Gallio, proconsul of Achaia in the year 51-52. That's one of the linchpins of our dating of the New Testament because archaeological evidence has been found that tells us about Gallio coming to power. When that was, we can date it to the month of when Gallio came to power. And we don't need the Bible to do that. And that's about the time that Paul is in Corinth, because as we'll see tonight when we read about this, or tomorrow, this Gallio is sitting in judgment after some people try to beat up the Christians. And they go before Gallio. And Gallio says, what do I care about your problems? Go solve them yourself. But you can see, I'll just mention one other thing, that there's a letter to the Galatians. Tonight we're going to talk about Galatians. There's letters to the Thessalonians in AD 50. And then in sessions tomorrow, we'll be doing letters to the Corinthians, 55 and 56. So the letters that Paul writes that we're going to be looking at in this session and the next session, these all have a place in the life of Paul. They have a place under Roman imperial rule, and they are part of the chronology of the rise of the early church. Notice, secondly, the doxological nature of Paul's teaching. This is on page 240. There's a sidebar. And it contains the six ascriptions of glory to God. When you ascribe glory to God, that's a doxology. Of course, we have the famous doxology in our worship services, which is just Psalm 100, or part of it set to music. We call it the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow, etc. That's a doxology. And people read Paul's teachings, or they read Paul's letters for all kinds of reasons. Some of them noble and some of them nefarious. But I'm quite certain that because Paul taught it and Paul lived it, he understood his life, he understood the life of the people of God to be lived for God's glory. Everything you do, we are to do for the glory of God. So as you study Paul's letters, as you read the chapter on Paul, you know, you can get into archaeology, you can get into ethics, you can get into his social teaching, you can get into tongues, you can get into spiritual gifts, you get into Christology, you can get into the cross, you can get all kinds of doctrines and background material, but don't lose sight of the biggest and the broadest thrust of Paul's conviction, which was that God would receive the honor and the glory that we as his creatures were designed to give to him. You know, that's when we're in sync with God, is when we are deferring to him and our lives are a credit to who he is. And that's when we're happiest, actually. It's just like in marriage, when you're giving your spouse her due, that's when she's happiest. And that's when you're going to be happiest. If you're a husband, a husband should be living in such a way that it conduces to his wife's happiness. Now, we're not perfect. And so no wife is happy all the time, and no husband is capable of making his wife happy all the time, and some of us not even very much of the time. But when it does happen, you know, it's wonderful, isn't it? And that's why we're on earth. We're on earth to live in such a way that God delights in us. And we grow in delighting in God's pleasure with us. So Paul's teaching is doxological in nature. I need to also mention, maybe not for you so much, but for your children and grandchildren, because over the years, increasingly, it's made it even into our schools. I know both my children were taught in public schools, that the founder of Christianity was Paul. Paul founded Christianity. Abraham founded Judaism. And Paul founded Christianity. And, you know, unfortunately, Jesus really wasn't much like what Paul said he was, but there you have it. And I've got this sidebar on page 244 that mentions the foundational agreement between Jesus and Paul. Jesus taught that salvation is from the Jews. He taught that the Old Testament scripture cannot be set aside or broken. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. When you study Jesus' teachings, he's coming in fulfillment of the Old Testament scriptures. And again, he appeals to the Old Testament scriptures to help explain what he stands for and why he's there and what the will of God is and what the character of God is. Well, Paul comes along and he says the same thing that Jesus did. Salvation flows from what God did in Old Testament times. And in Romans 9, 4, and 5, he mentions 8 gifts of God to Israel that are also gifts to gospel believers. Adoption into the people of God. Israel enjoyed this. We enjoy this. We become children of Abraham by faith. God's glorious presence, his Shekinah glory, it's called. You remember on the Mount of Transfiguration, Jesus lit up. You know, to a Jew, that made them think of Moses, or that made them think of other times in the Old Testament where there was this radiant presence of the divine, which was actually terrifying. But that is something that Christians have the benefit of that was inaugurated in the Old Testament times. The covenants. The covenant with Noah, the covenant actually with Adam and Eve, the covenant with Abraham, the covenant with David, and so forth. The receiving of the law, the Torah, temple worship. In the New Testament, we're told that our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit. And the church is a place where God's people convene and commune with God. The church is a temple. The promises, we're saved through God's promises. The patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they had a God. He's also our God. And the Messiah, who is called God in Romans 9, 5. So as we go to Paul's letters, again, we're seeing an explication of the good news of Jesus Christ, but we're not seeing the founding of something that Jesus didn't foresee, even though that's how it's presented in a lot of scholarship. That's how it's taught in a lot of our history of civ classes in college and in high schools, but it's, I think, not a sound approach. Just a few other items here. Paul's high Christology. And by that I mean, not that he was smoking something, but that there's a Christology from below. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. You know, you can study the Gospels and just look at how Jesus conducted himself as a human being. You know, and people didn't know he was the Son of God. And they didn't know what that meant. He hadn't died and risen yet. So, you know, we can study Jesus from the point of view of the folks who watched him. And, you know, they thought, you know, he must be a prophet. And, you know, and then they haggled over, what does he mean? And what is he here for? And is he good? Is he bad? What do the leaders of the people say? What do you think? And Jesus even said, who do people say I am? You know, that's Christology from below. Of course, Christology is the doctrine of Christ. So you can call it Jesusology. You can study Jesus just from his everyday life. But then when you get all the evidence in, and at the end of this lowly, humble life, he ascends to the right hand of the Father. Well, when you look at it from that point of view, that's Christology from above. You know, when you take into account his exalted nature. And I love this statement on page 245 in the box that says High Christology. Possibly written by Polycarp of Smyrna. And so maybe in AD 140, roughly. And if it is written by Polycarp, the person who penned these words, he was a disciple of the Apostle John. So he's not, you know, John himself. Polycarp never saw Jesus, but he was tutored by John. And this epistle to Diognetus, I could say a lot about it, but basically it seems that Polycarp was a spiritual leader in an area, Smyrna. It's one of the seven churches of Asia. And you know, it turns out he gets martyred. So the guy that writes this, maybe 20 years later, he gets arrested and he's publicly martyred. But at this point, the government officials are just like asking him, what is this thing you're teaching? Because it was quite out of sync with Greco-Roman religions. It wasn't really legal yet in the Roman Empire. And so this is what this student of John said. He says that God sent Christ to people, to them. Was he sent, think you, as any man might suppose, to inspire fear and terror? Imagine Polycarp saying this, as I think he was, to a pagan government official. Do you think that he came, because, you know, one of the things the Romans didn't like is they heard about the destruction that was to come and that Jesus was going to return and judge the world. And they hold, that's an awful teaching. We don't want people running around being frightened and frightening others. So Polycarp says, do you think that's why he came? Not so, but in gentleness and meekness has he sent him, as a king might send his son who is a king. He sent him as sending God. He sent him as a man unto men. He sent him as Savior, as using persuasion, not force, for force, that is, coercion, is no attribute of God. He sent him as loving, not judging. Oh, the sweet exchange. Oh, the inscrutable creation. Oh, the unexpected benefits, that the iniquity of many should be concealed in one righteous man, and the righteousness of one should justify many that are iniquitous. Having then in the former time demonstrated the inability of our nature to obtain life, he's talking about that one of the net effects of the Old Testament, we see that people keep screwing up. and people need a Savior. He says, and having now revealed a Savior, able to save even creatures which have no ability, he willed that for both reasons we should believe in his goodness and should regard him, Christ, as nurse, father, teacher, counselor, physician, mind, light, honor, glory, strength, and life. That's ascribing a lot of praise to Christ, and that's a high Christology. And Paul didn't write this, but he wouldn't disagree with any of it. So as we study Paul's writings, he'll say all kinds of things about Jesus and all kinds of things about Christ Jesus and Jesus Christ. But he comes from a point of view. He's not wondering, is Jesus the Son of God? He's quite clear that he's been exalted to God's right hand. We need to take a 5-minute break, so I'll see you then. And if anybody wants to look at any of these books, feel free.